Psalm 101 and verses 4 through 8. This morning's sermon is entitled, "The Heart is Crucial to Everything." The psalmist says this, the inspiration of God's Spirit, in verse 4. "A perverse heart shall depart from me. I will know no evil. Whoever secretly slanders his neighbor, him I will destroy. No one who has a haughty look and an arrogant heart will I endure. My eyes shall be upon the faithful of the land, that they may dwell with me. He who walks in a blameless way is the one who will minister to me. He who practices deceit shall not dwell within my house. He who speaks falsehood shall not maintain his position before me. Every morning I will destroy all the wicked of the land, so as to cut off from the city of the Lord those who do iniquity." Let us pray. Lord God, as we consider this text, we pray that your Spirit would lead us and guide us into all truth this morning, God. For what is understanding without your Spirit? We have none. God, I pray that in humility and faith we might come before you and ask just of this precious thing, that you would fill us with your Spirit, God. That we might know you, that we might feel you, that we might have a closer walk with you as a result of being in this house this morning, God. It's not the place, but it's the person. It's the person of Jesus Christ. That's what we ask for. That's what we long for this morning, God. We ask that he might be magnified and that you might use this service for your honor and for your glory. And we might be able to say into this, it has indeed been good to be in the house of the Lord this day. God, let it be. Let it be because you're good and you're faithful, not us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Three pastors were going to a convention and they were all sharing one room. Oh boy, you talk about not getting much sleep, amen. Just talk all night. The first pastor said, "Let's confess our sins to one another." I'll start. My secret sin is I just love to gamble. When I go out of town, it's cha-ching, let the machines ring. Boy, when people aren't watching us, we can get away with some stuff, can't we? The second pastor said, my secret sin is I just hate to work. I copy all my sermons given from those from other pastors, and I just hate to work. The third pastor said, my secret sin is gossiping, and oh boy, I just can't wait to get out of this room. The heart is at the matter of everything, though, isn't it? A lot of sinful people. I'm a very sinful man dwelling in the midst of sinful men and women, but the heart is everything. In Psalm 101, we have a list of what to do and what not to do in order to be effective followers of Christ. What we must not take our eyes off of, though, in this text is that everything begins and ends right here in the heart of the matter. God's Spirit fills my heart. When I received Jesus Christ, I asked him to come into my heart and to save me from my sins. The heart. For it is not the external that defiles the man, it is the internal. It is not what goes into the man that defiles the man, it is what comes out of the man that defiles the man. For what comes out of the man comes from the heart. The heart of the matter. Where is your heart this morning? Is your heart given to the person of Jesus Christ? Is your heart filled with the Spirit of God? Is your heart walking with God, or is your heart darkened? Is the Spirit quenched? Is the fellowship not there? Where's your heart this morning? This directly confronts our internal being, our spirit, which is what God is after. He is the lover of the soul. The soul. You want a man to transform, don't look to the external, look to the internal, the soul. God is after the soul of mankind this morning, and we preach in this way that God is after you this morning. I thought a wonderful comment given in Sunday school class this morning. You know, we have to wait on God, but so often God is waiting on us to come to him, to find rest in him, to walk with him, to live and move and have our being in him. So the effective follower of Christ will, first of all, in verse 4, and this is what we really want to look into this morning, and regardless of this list, we're going to begin and end with verse 4. But the effective follower of Christ will attend to his heart. Will attend to his heart. Jeremiah 17, 9 and 10. Listen to some of these various verses. The heart is deceitful above all else and beyond cure. Who can understand it? Listen to this. I, the Lord, search the heart and examine the mind to reward a man according to his conduct, according to what deeds he deserves. Psalm 4:23, above all else, guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life. Right here in the heart. When I'm walking with God, I have this life that exudes my spirit and my walk, this glow. It's all over some of you at times. When I'm not walking with God, it's not there. That doesn't stem from the external, and I can't turn it on and off when I want to. That stems from the heart. For myself, I tend to show my emotions a lot. It's hard to cover up. You know, if I'm not really walking with God the way I need to, you can see it. It's not a mystery. But if I'm walking with God the way I need to, you can see that also. It's there. The spirit of God and the heart, that life that's inside of me stems from the heart, and it doesn't stem from myself. It stems from my relationship with him that is Jesus Christ, the lover and the savior of our soul. Proverbs 16:23 says, a wise man's heart guides his mouth, but his lips will promote instruction. And who is wise but the one that is filled with the Spirit of God? Amen. And where is wisdom but found in God, in the Word of God, and in the person of God, that is Jesus Christ? Folks, this morning I can say this bluntly, there is not one wise person in this room outside of Jesus Christ. Totally and purely, I'm found to be wise in and of him. And as I find myself to be weak, I am strong, because I depend then less on myself and I depend then more on him. Amen. And that's the Spirit of God. And that's what God's movement is. It's funny, you know, we think about ourselves and our intellect and everything about us. Me, 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 look at me, listen to me. But it has nothing to do with any of you. It has everything to do with God. And so surely as we decrease, as John the Baptist did, we might increase through his Spirit to his praise. The wise man, Proverbs 22:11 says this, he who loves a pure heart and he whose speech is gracious will have the king for his friend. And I praise God, I've got the King of Kings for my friend this morning, amen. And listen to this, folks. His name is not Donald Trump, it's not Barack Obama, it's not Vladimir Putin, it's not anyone else. His name is Jesus Christ, amen. That's my friend. That's my secure friend. That's my stable friend. That's my constant and steadfast friend. I've got a friend this morning. A friend that the Bible would also tell us this, sticks closer than a brother. And that brotherly love in the Bible, last time I checked, is pretty affectionate. This friend even closer than that, and a greater lover of the soul than that. What a friend, as the old hymn might say, we have in Jesus. Is there one like him? No, there's not. There's not one. He is my friend. Do you know him this morning? Do you have a friend in him this morning? Proverbs 23:7 will go on to say this, as a man thinketh in his heart, so he is. Proverbs 27:19, talking a lot about the heart here, aren't we? As water reflects a face, so a man's heart reflects the man. Jesus, in dealing with the hypocrites, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, condemned them in Matthew 12:34 and said this, you brood of vipers, how can you who are evil say anything good? For out of the overflow of the heart speaks the mouth. Matthew 22:37, Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart. And you know what you can do then? You can love the Lord your God with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind. He said, this is the first and the greatest commandment, though. But my friends, don't forget this. The first that comes is the heart. The heart. And so we look at the society and we say, man, we're in trouble. People are hurting. Things going from bad to worse. Look at the violence. Look at the hate. Look at the anger. Look at the strife. Look at everything. But folks, you know what could change everything is if the heart changed. Because the heart problem, it's an internal problem. It's because the heart does not know God in so many cases, or even in the church, is really not walking with God. I will not know wickedness means I will not have a perverse heart. I will not know wickedness means I will only seek to know goodness. A perverse heart shall depart from me. I will know no evil. It will not overtake me. It will not overcome me. For I will always take inventory of my heart and make sure that my heart is walking with God in Jesus Christ. I will confront my heart daily in this way. And then in verse 5, the effective follower of Christ will attend to his soul. The psalmist says this: whoever secretly slanders his neighbor, him I will destroy. No one who has a haughty look and an arrogant heart will I endure. Verses 5 through 7 reveal the kind of men an effective follower will surround himself with, both in negative and positive categories. The effective follower also must be this kind of person, and he will wisely seek out others of like-mindedness. Hebrews says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together, as is the manner of some. And as much as we can get on each other's nerves sometimes, boy, we need each other, amen. We need each other. We need this uplifting. We need this exhortation. We need this grace and this mercy of the like-minded believers that were once lost in sin, but praise God, now they've been saved and been brought to the wonderful light that is Jesus Christ. Is that your story? If that's your story, then, hey, you might get on my nerves sometimes, but I'm just going to be honest. I need to be around you, amen. Because we got the same thing. And the commonality is Jesus Christ. And I have more in common with my saved brother in Uganda than I do with my lost neighbor across the street, amen. Than my sister and my family that doesn't know Christ. Than my brother that doesn't know Christ. Than my son or my daughter that doesn't know Christ. I have more in common with the believer in China. Because it's all about the heart. It's all about the heart. It's a matter of the heart. He moves to the soul. Note the threefold criteria in negative categories in verse 5. A slander, a haughty look, and a proud heart. Note the reverse connection. A proud heart will lead to a haughty look, which will give way to a lying tongue. And pride is at the essence. The godly follower will not tolerate this in himself or others because he's always looking at himself in the mirror. He's always watching his reflection to see if his look has changed. You know, we're told that the eyes are the window to the soul. And sometimes when a man pauses and looks at himself in the mirror and takes note of himself, he can note change. To take spiritual inventory where you're at daily. Because when you get on that slippery slope, sometimes it's hard to stop unless you look at yourself, unless you take the time to catch yourself. David says with strong poetic power, him I will not endure. He will silence them and set them aside to negate that cancerous influence that can be inside of us, that can be beside us. He will confront, speaking the truth with love, and he will show them the error. He will show himself the error. The effective follower will recognize the potent power of the tongue. James talks about the tongue, and we talk about all this sin, and boy, it's all over the place in our world. But what about gossip? What about the sins of the church? You think about how much damage you can do with your tongue in terms of gossip. You can talk a person right out of here and right out of church for the rest of their life. How much damage we do with our tongue. A deadly evil full of poison. Destroy. Slander and gossip are twin spiritual plagues. They're flirting with destruction. Mocking and deception is madmen playing with fire. Obscenity and vulgarity is ungodly speech that degrades both the speaker and the listener. Profanity is trivializing the sacred and evidence of a lazy and impure mind. The effective follower of Christ in verse 6 will find the faithful. It says this, my eyes shall be upon the faithful of the land. that they may dwell with me. He who walks in a blameless way is the one who will minister to me. The wise man will surround himself with men that are faithful. Men that are faithful. The wise man will surround himself with men that are blameless, who have a servant's heart. Only in this way can I advance in the work of the Lord. Help. Help in this way. Psalm 1:1 is a healthy reminder at this point. Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked. Not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of scoffers, or sit in the seat of mockers. Blessed is the man that does not listen to that advice, but rather heeds those that are walking with God that are around him, who's spending time with these people. If I'm going to be a faithful follower of Jesus Christ, I have to have people around me that are pushing me and pressing me towards the upwards call of God in Christ Jesus. Friends and co-workers and family members that will never let me settle and never let me lose grip on the call that God has on my life. Amen. Those that will always remind me of what God has done for me. Those that will always remind me of where God brought me from and point me forward to where God is taking me to. Amen. Not those that will pull me down, but those that are going to bring me up. Amen. You know, and it's a lot easier to encourage people to do the right thing than it is to discourage them from doing the wrong thing. What is the blessing of church? Are you just here to see people and waste time? It's Sunday. This is a day off. You could sit back and chill at the house and watch television and sleep and eat all day. What is the positive about church? Well, the positive about church is there's a God in heaven who gave his son, Jesus Christ, on the cross for your sins, amen. And he placed on him the sins of you and everyone else in this world. And he raised him from the dead as a stamp of approval. And in him there is grace, there is mercy, and there is salvation alone. That is the positive to church, amen. If you weren't a sinner, there wouldn't be a lot of positive to church. But folks, you're all sinners. And you're all on your way to hell outside of the grace and mercy that is found to be in the person, God's only Son, that is Jesus Christ. Amen. There is benefit to church. I'm not a bedside Baptist. Amen. I'm a Jesus Christ follower. The effective follower of Christ will find faithful to be encouraged. We need church. Verse 7. Notice this verse. He who practices deceit shall not dwell within my house. He who speaks falsehood will not maintain his position before me. Boy, the psalmist is doing spiritual inventory of himself and of those around him. This is difficult. In a society that screams, "Don't judge me, let me live my life." Well, the psalmist does a little judging. Amen. Through the Spirit of God. He does a little confrontation, but he does it in love. He speaks the truth, and this is what the truth does, amen. The truth doesn't always pat you on the back and say you're good. The truth says, no, you're in error, and you need to find your way, so I love you, I'm going to help you. And this is the truth that sets us free. Why let it be a person be caught in bondage when we have the truth that can set them free? The disloyal, dishonest, unfaithful, hypocritical, liars, gossipers, and divisive are not a part of the effective followers' inner circle. Once again, this man of integrity will take inventory, considering himself, lest he also be tempted, as Galatians 6:2 would say. Because cancer spreads. Spreads. And we got to know that. If there is anything in his family that is questionable, in himself that is questionable, he will deal with it. He will deal with it because he knows what is at stake. And it's a lot more than we could ever imagine. Verse 8, the effective follower understands what is at stake. What is at stake? Every morning I will destroy all the wicked of the land so as to cut off from the city of the Lord all those who do iniquity. Early is rendered by most translations either as every morning or morning by morning. With each new day, the man of God will confront the wicked and seek their defeat. He will not grow weary in this fight. He will not surrender to those who do evil in the land. And this is not just speaking of people around him. No, this is speaking of principalities, demonic powers that wage war against him. This is speaking of himself and his fallen nature, his flesh. To this he will also wage war. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. He will wage war against all of these, and he will overcome daily through the spirit and the power of the God that is for him. And if this God is for you, my friends, this morning, who can be against you? What height, what depth can separate you from the love of God that is in Jesus Christ? Greater is he that is inside of me than he that is in the world. Amen. The truth, the reality of this relationship. And as I fill my heart with God and surrender the things of this world, I am filled with the Holy Spirit, and I can with confidence confess, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Now ask that question with verse 8, what is at stake? Everything. What is at stake? Everything. You know, I'm a saved, born-again Christian. A lot of you are saved, born-again Christians. But let us not waste our lives. And to me, that's the scariest reality that could be. But I praise God, I'm going to go and claim by faith it's not going to be. Amen. The wasted life. That is, whatever people expect from you, whatever expectations society has of you, forget it. And surrender to the expectation and to the call that God has for you. Amen. Because my dear friends, let me tell you something. The expectation of your friends, maybe even your family, of this society, usually is a lot different than the expectation that God has for you. What does he want from you? I just can't help but think we got some young pastors in here this morning. Some people are going to say no. But you say yes. Amen. We got some missionaries in here this morning, so people are going to say no. But you say yes, amen. We got Sunday school teachers. We got transformed lives waiting to be transformed, amen. And so people are saying no, you can't change. But God is saying yes, you can, amen. He's saying yes. Everybody, let everybody else say no, but let this be known that our God says yes, amen. If you come to him in faith and humility, he will say yes, and he will bring you to this way of life that is only found in him. Spiritual inventory in terms of God. As I understand the heart is important for the pastor, for the teacher, for every man and woman that has ever lived, is living, or will ever live. Doug Field says this, though, in regards to ministry. Don't allow increasing ministry to decrease your intimacy. And don't let your service exceed your worship. For then, my friends, you will no longer be effective. My spiritual lifeline is God. My effectiveness is God. My ability is God. And all of it therein, amen. And as I trust him in this way, I found it. John Calvin said this, that nearly all the wisdom we need comes in two parts, the knowledge of God and knowledge of ourselves. That means you've got to know God and you've got to know your own heart. Don't be a stranger to your own heart. Keep your heart with all vigilance. A.W. Pink says this, watch your heart for changes and trends. Notice what he says, for the Christian to keep his heart means for him to pay close attention to the direction in which his affections are moving. Pay close attention to this. To discover whether the things of the world are gaining a firmer and fuller hold over him, or whether they are increasingly losing their charm for him. And if the things of the world are gaining a fuller and more controllable hold over your life, then your heart is becoming darkened, my friends, amen. And you need to put some light on that heart, amen. You need a transformation that comes from the Spirit of God, because as we grow in terms of God and his grace and mercy, and as our heart is exposed to light, and as we get deeper, you know what we tend to do with the things of this world? We tend to leave them behind a little bit, amen. Surrender. Watch the direction in which the things are moving in your heart. Keep your heart with all vigilance. The momentum of sin which always begins in the heart, is like a stone rolling down a hill. It is easy to stop at the beginning, but once it gains momentum, it's very difficult to stop. Very difficult to stop. You know, there's a lot of people that are in bondage to substances, to sex, to different things this morning, but they didn't begin in bondage. They wound up there. It started with just a look, with just a taste, just a drop. And before you know it, and before you're through, you've become something you never thought you were capable of being. And you look at yourself in the mirror, and really deep down inside, you hate yourself. And you're filled with regret, and you know that you were created to be something more, that you were created to do something so much more than what you're doing right now. And truthfully, deep down, it hurts. And you try to escape the pain, and you constantly bury it and smother it, but the pain never goes away, amen. The regret is always there. The hurt, the sting is always there. Never meant to get here. I don't know how I got here, but I'm here. That's bad news. That's true news. Let me give you good news. That's also true news. Regardless of how far you've fallen, regardless of how much darkness you're in, regardless of how many chains have you bound to the tree of sin and death, there is one that can break those chains, amen. There is a deliverer this morning, amen. There is salvation this morning, amen. And the way of salvation, the way of escape, folks, you can read all the self-help books you want. Keep popping the pills. Go see your psychologist. There's only one way out. I'm telling you what. You say, well, everything's not spiritual. My friends, everything is spiritual because everything is God, amen. And the only one that can break that bondage, the only one that can set you free this morning is this. His name is Jesus Christ, amen. And he said this, you can know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And what is truth? Who is truth? Let me just tell you his name. It's got five letters. J-E-S-U-S. That is the truth. Amen. That is the bondage breaker. That is the sinner savior. That is the life-changing power that's available to everyone who would call on that name this morning from sincerity of heart, asking for that change, asking for that help. If you ask of him, if you beg of him, you might just get it. But my friends, know this, you'll never be the same. And all that regret and all that pain and all that hurt, you can flush it down the toilet. Jesus said this, behold, you're a new creature in Christ. Through the Spirit of God and Paul and Corinthians, the old has passed and the new has come. Have you tasted this? Have you felt this? Have you seen this? Look around. Some of you were these people, but you're not any longer. Why? Simply because of that name, amen, this morning. Praise God for that name. So keep your heart with all vigilance. Watch for the first flicker of a red light on the dashboard, because normally there are many to follow. And if your heart is locked down this morning, then I would just simply ask of this, that you might come and be touched by a hand that is not seen but unseen. And if you come believing by faith and humility, and if you call upon that name, you know what he'll do? He will set the captive free. He is the deliverer. He is the way of escape. He is the way of salvation. You don't need the help of a preacher. It doesn't matter who preached. Let me leave this pulpit. There is a God here who saves and transforms lives. Let him have his way this morning. Amen. Because my dear friends, this is about God and this is about you. Let's stand together. And if God is speaking to your heart, won't you come? Prayer, rededication, salvation. I know there's a voice that speaks, and there's a lot of clutter in the air, but drown it all out. Let that voice speak to your heart. Let him have your soul. He wants you this morning. He wants to go deeper. Won't you let him have his way this morning? Just surrender all. Just give it up for him. Brother Joel, if you would.